every time in the video game where you stumble or you fall, or maybe you're playing Mario Kart and you not Mario Kart, Super Mario, and you run into the little mushroom creatures and you die, you can reset the game and come back right as new. Well, we know that life does not work like that in reality. It just doesn't work. We don't have a reset button in our week. So I don't know, some of you have come here with troubles and worries and you're like, man, I wish I could reset my week. Well, guess what? There's a man named David in the Bible, and all of you know David. He said something that we all know, but I'm going to give it a fresh new perspective with my help. Brian actually gave me the fresh perspective of what David said. Check this out. You guys know this verse. Create in me a new heart. And it's interesting because the word that he uses for create in Hebrew is barach. Can you say that with me? Barach. Say that with me. Barach. Create. And this word is used in the beginning when God created the world from nothing to something. And so is it possible that God can create a new heart? Can he barah in you a new heart today? I definitely believe it. I believe God can give you a new heart right now. So thank you so much for coming to Living Word Fellowship Church. We believe in this God where he gives a brand new heart. He barah you a new heart.
Would you please join us in singing This Is My Desire? This is my desire.
This is my desire.
To honor you.
To honor you.
Lord, with all my heart.
Lord, with all my heart, I worship you.
All I have within me, I give you praise.
All I have.
All that I adore is in you.
All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take,
a time where we can come together collectively and pray to God. It was told to me once by a professor of mine back at Southern Adventist University that reading your Bible is like eating, that service to others is like exercise, but prayer is like breathing. And I want to invite all of you right now to join me in a collective breath to God as we pray. Heavenly Father, just want to thank you, Lord, for the blessings that you have given to all of us here in this church. I want to thank you, Lord, for being an amazing God, for knowing the beginning from the end in each and every one of our lives. And I want to thank you, Lord, for the different signposts that you place in front of each and every one of us, Lord, directing us where you'd like us to go in our lives, Lord, wherever that may be. And however that may look. Lord, some of us this week maybe haven't talked to you much, haven't even thought about talking to you for whatever reason. But Lord, this is a time where we can all talk to you, Lord. This is a time where we can, as Andres said, press that reset button, Lord, as we begin a new week. Father, I ask that you forgive us of our sins, as you've already done, but some of us are dealing with guilt. And I ask you, Lord, that you help to heal those people, Lord, struggling with guilt. And help them, Lord, through that struggle, to come to you. I also want to pray for those, Lord, who have had amazing weeks, who have had amazing news this week or in the past weeks, Lord. Lord, continue to affirm them in what you've called them, Lord. And right now, as we get to hear the message from Pastor Brian, I want to ask, Lord, for a special blessing over him. And Lord, he is aware that you are in control. And I ask, Lord, that the words that are not just his, Lord, but they be yours, and help him, Father, to stand behind the cross. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. In Jesus' name, amen.
I was just about to say good morning, but I guess it's good afternoon now. Good afternoon, happy Sabbath. For those of us that are here, also happy Sabbath, and good afternoon, those of us that are joining online. Before we begin, let's begin with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, as we get started, even before we even touch on this subject, we want to thank you and praise you that you are here with us right now, that you are guiding us, that you are preparing us for what you have. Father, I ask that as we take a look at the subject, his go and our follow, that you would help us to more fully understand what this means and what it means to us right now. If there's anything preventing our hearts, our minds from listening to your voice, take that away so that we're able to hear you more fully. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, when they heard the words, they thought that he was out of his mind. His friends, his family, and his community around him thought he was crazy when Jim Elliot told them that he and some other people were going to go to Ecuador. First thing that entered their mind, how nuts are you to even think about leaving the United States, let alone try to go to a nation, a country that doesn't believe in God, that doesn't want the message there. But you have to understand, Jim Elliot had a heart that was set on fire by God with a passion for other people. So the day came where him, his friends, went with their families down to Ecuador. But then the news came, news that even surprised the community again, where they heard that he accepted another call to go further inland in Ecuador. First letters that came out to him, are you that crazy? Going and trying to reach these people that want absolutely nothing to do with you, want nothing to do with the message that you stand for? And time again, Elliot would write back and he says, it's not my message, it's God's message. Which isn't that what we're all about? We're about going and preaching God's message. Not what we think it is, but what he says it is. And so they make their plans to head out to a remote village, planting themselves several miles away from this village. and little by little trying to introduce themselves to the natives there. What they would do is they would take their material in their plane, and they would go up and they would let down a basket to where the natives could grab the stuff out of the basket while trying to make general contact with them. As time went on, they thought that they had connected with the people because one of the villagers started to come, started to speak to them, started to look as though they wanted some type of connection with them. Little did Elliot know that this person was going back and was spreading lies to the other villagers. Day came where they thought that they might be able to go to the village, and so they gathered up their supplies and they started going the short trek to the village. However, at that exact moment, there were 10 warriors that were on that same path, on a war path, ready to kill them. If he had just known what was going to happen, I wonder if he would have gone. But by reading Elliot, we know that because of his passion, because of his love for God, he would have gone even if he knew that that day he was going to be killed. They go down the war path. They're met by the warriors. It cannot even come into our minds what not only a tragedy happened that day, but what they went through when they were being tortured and killed. Their bodies were found several days later. Days after that, people, their families were going through their stuff. And as they were going through Elliot's belongings, they ran across his journal. And as they opened it, one of the entries in his journal says this. It says, "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain which he cannot lose." Elliot knew what it meant to follow. He knew what it meant when the master says go, you go. Because he has a purpose for what he's asking you to do. Today I want us to take a look at the passage that we looked at in our scripture reading. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28, and we're going to be starting in verse 16. Matthew chapter 28, starting in verse 16. As we're looking for that, let's talk about this for just a moment. In the previous verses of the chapter, we see how the disciples are still trying to get over the very torture of knowing their master had just died, of not being sure as to what they could do in order to go forward. But then we also see a shift. We see that Sunday morning. Oh, there are days that I wish I could have been there that Sunday morning. Can you imagine right before daybreak, where everything is calm, everything is quiet, the birds are just waking up, dawn is just on the horizon, and then all of a sudden, it's not 10 angels, it's not 20 angels, it's one angel. Gabriel himself comes down. Soldiers go flat. Demons go running. The power of one angel with a message. Hey, Jesus, it's time to go. It's time to wake up. rolls away the stone. But we see that, and then we see another shift, which we're going to touch on in just a moment. But verse 16, I hope you're there right now. Verse 16 says this, and it says, "But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had designated." You know, it's interesting right here. There's several key words that make you stop and make you wonder why they put it in the Bible to start with. One of those words happens to be "but." The reason why that "but" is there is it's Matthew is drawing a direct contrast. He's saying there's something going on before this that you need to pay attention to. And the exact thing that is happening before this, we see the soldiers being bribed. We see the priests coming up to him, the people of God that should have been actually giving the message, instead bribing the soldiers, saying, "Hey, I know you think you saw this, but hey, throw some good money at you. I want you to tell our version of the story. I want you to take this false story and make it true." That's why Matthew throws this "but" in there. You see the faults, but all of a sudden he says, "Hey, right here, here's a group that's still following. Here's a group that believes in what Jesus is teaching, believes in who he is, and is still going forward." But not just going forward, going to the specific place where he asks them to go, specifically looking at the Mount of Olives. Verse 17, continuing on, says, "When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted." Yet once again, that "but." You know, it's interesting. Often we say, you know, if Jesus was only here, I would believe in him. When we forget, even the very disciples, when Jesus was right in front of them, we still see people doubting. And that still happens today. Even if we had him right in front of us, there would be people still doubting, going, "Are you really who you say you are? Or am I seeing something else?" You know, this is what the disciples were having a problem with here too. Because even in their own tradition, even in their own thinking, the Jews believed that after someone died, that their manifestation still could come and appear. So you see a still doubt on the minds, on the hearts of some of these people that takes weeks after to fully dissolve. This whole concept is very important, especially as we transition into this next verse. Verse 18 looks and says this. It says, "And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.'" Knowing that they're still doubting right here, he's going, "Hey, I've got something I want to tell you. And here it is." Okay. Before he says this, we see him coming up from a spot. It doesn't say where, but coming up onto the top of the Mount of Olives where the disciples would have been. And then that's where he says, "All authority has been given to me," where? Oh, so here on Andrews, and that's just it. So here at Andrews University, nowhere else, right? No, in heaven and on earth. Here's what we miss. when we look at this verse, if we're looking at it correctly, we would get what Jesus is saying, and the disciples have the idea. Jesus is saying right here, guess what? Authority is mine already. When I came here, I took off the mantle, but now the mantle's on again. What was mine is still mine, and it is forever mine, because I am who I am. Jesus being the very creator himself, we see authority was already his from even before there ever was, all the way to the end and beyond. And because authority is his, I want you to notice this. This is a very vital point as we're going into verse 19. Verse 19 connects very well with 18. It says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." When God says, go, he doesn't ask us not to question. He doesn't ask us not to say why, but what he does ask us to do is he says, follow me. Because I have a reason why I ask you to go where I've asked you to go. But brings in a very interesting topic. He says, therefore go and make what? Make sheep? Well, we already have a lot of sheep. Therefore, go and make disciples. How often is it that instead of going and making disciples, we are going and fleecing another flock? Ooh, maybe we shouldn't touch on that subject. Go and make disciples. In other words, go and teach people who I am. Bring people into a saving relationship with me. Showing people how great it is to serve a God that loves them no matter what. Where you look at all these other religions and they serve God out of fear. But I'm about love. I'm about love. Yes, I want you to fear me because it's the highest form of respect, highest form of worship. But I want you to love me because you want a connection with me. But you bring him into a relationship. Next thing is baptism. Just like with marriage. Two people come and they love each other so much that they say, hey, I want to make a public proclamation of how much I love this person. That's what baptism is. Saying to the world, I love Jesus so much that I want to take this step out in faith and proclaim to the world that I will forever follow him. But here's something that we miss. I know in the baptism, you'll see the pastor raising his hand or elder or whoever's doing the baptism, saying in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. I missed it. I missed the point in there where Jesus is introducing a new form of logic right here. Jesus is saying, listen, it is not just about me, it's about the three. Did you get that? Jesus was continually coming back to that in and through every point of his ministry. The whole fact that I am not here because of myself. I am not here in and of myself to get the glory. I am here to throw the glory back. when I get glory, it goes to the Father. It goes to the Spirit. We all share in the glory. It's about the three. It's not about the me. We work together to help you go forward. But that's where we bring into verse 20. Verse 20 says this. It says, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Bringing them into that relationship. Baptizing them. And then going that next step, teaching them what Jesus taught us to do. In other words, don't just leave them. Show them how to live. Show them why to live. And show them why God asks us that no matter what's going on in this world, no matter what may be seeming to happen in the church, to live. To live the life. But here's something that's important. And that's why this whole go and follow principle is so essential. It's because of this, where Jesus says, I am with you always. Jesus didn't say, I'm with you sometimes. Jesus didn't say, I'm possibly with you. Jesus didn't say, I might be with you when you're doing what's right. Jesus said, I am with you always. No matter what's going on, I'm with you. No matter where you are in this world, I am with you. But not only that, guess what? I am with you to the end of the age. And when Jesus said that, the disciples would have known that that meant from now till the end and to eternity. When God makes a promise, He always sees it through. Because He's a God that goes with us. He's a God that is with us continually. And He's a God that will never let us down. That's why that's why Jim Elliot, in his journal, was able to pen those lines. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain which he cannot lose. Because Eliot knew what it meant to not only follow God, but follow a God that continues to go forward, asking us to follow Him no matter what. Father, how true it is that moment by moment, not only are you with us, but you're continually guiding us as you go and as we follow. Father, as we leave this place today, help us to take these lessons that we've learned to be able to go forward into what you've called us to do. Whether that be next door, across the street, in this community, or across the world, you've called us to follow you and to follow through. Be with us, bless us, guide us through this next week. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.